Sleep tight, my baby. Lie still and sleep. It grieves me so to see you weep. This is a Scottish folk song that appears in Johannes Brahms' first intermezzo from 3 Intermezzi, opus 117. It alludes to a lullaby that brings with it not only a desire for rest and quiet, but also feelings of distress and worry, whether it is really a child or Brahms himself. These 3 intermezzi of Brahms are perhaps the most intimate of his works and act as his own monologue. You can hear the cradle carrying Brahms swaying from side to side, from right to left and from left to right in all 3 intermezzi. From right to left and to the right. Brahms' miniatures are in the form of ABA, in which part B is the opposite of part A. These 3 miniatures represent light versus dark, the longings for togetherness versus Brahms' loneliness. A year after Brahms met Robert and Clara Schumann and became a regular tenant in their house, he wrote to his friend, the violinist Joachim, about Clara. While I respect and admire her, it is as if she has cast a spell on me. Sometimes I force myself not to wrap my arms around her. It seems so natural to me that I believe it will not make her uncomfortable. I do not think I will be able to love young women. I have completely forgotten about their existence. They are just a promise of heaven, whereas with Clara, it is heaven. Brahms and Clara were moral people, therefore the relationship between them was only platonic. Even after the tragic death of Robert Schumann, Clara continued to be the beloved and dominant figures in Brahms' life for another 40 years. During that time, his music was colored by feelings of great loneliness, longings, and pain of unrequited love, and acceptance of a bittersweet reality. In his first intermezzo in E flat major, part A is all light and harmony and sounds almost like a chorale. The melody is in the inner voice and it is enveloped and caressed by the outer voices. The melody with the other voices. The beginning of the melody is well-known Brahms motif. The opening 2 notes, which form a quarta, sounds almost like a cry of love, and this is followed by the descent and surrender of the subsequent notes. It is almost as if he is ashamed of the momentary burst of love he feels, and he turns inward. The quarta, the descending notes. Part B of the intermezzo is the complete opposite, darkness and abysmal loneliness. The bright and long major melody of part A becomes short minor motifs of sighs and pain between Brahms and Clara. Brahms, Clara. The second intermezzo is in B flat minor. The A part is darkness and loneliness, which is written as a single melodic line that passes from hand to hand. The right hand weeps with the sigh motifs, and the left hand caresses and comforts her. Weeping, caresses. Part B is the complete opposite. Although the melody is the same, the melodic line has now become four voices together, and they are full of brotherhood and love. Later comes a short development section of the part A, which sounds like one in search of something unknown. Later you can hear the cradle of life that finds no rest. Weeping. Psi motive. The cradle. Right and to the left. The third intermezzo in C sharp minor begins as a solitary distant minor melodic line that sounds like ancient prayer in dark church. It also contains Brahms motif. The main theme is concentrated in one place on the piano and revolves around itself as if Brahms has lost his way. This melodic line will be painted by Brahms several times in marvelous and heartbreaking harmonic colors in many places throughout this intermezzo. And the middle part is the complete opposite, the A major scale, which spans all the piano's octaves in an up and down motion. In its highest point, it gives one the sensation of twinkling star or a bell of hope. When we approach the performances of pianists and their interpretations of different pieces, we should be aware of some elements. Who the composer is, what personal experiences the composer feels and writes from, what the thread is throughout their life, which affects their emotions, and their preference in the structure and form they use in their pieces. The piano allows Brahms to express his deepest feelings thanks to both the many registers and the harmonious possibilities of the piano. Those elements provide the opportunities to create chords with many colors and multiplicity of voices. Brahms felt unrequited love almost all in his life and corresponded in a very intimate way in his letters with Clara. So it makes sense that he also expressed these feelings through his music. He dreamed of her between the notes. He had imaginary conversations with her through the registers of the piano. He loved her through the colors of the chords. And he expressed his great pain and loneliness through the melodic lines. Pianist Gregory Sokolov expresses all these things in a very direct way. Sokolov provides great freedom to the emotions, tones, and love dialogue that takes place so clearly in Brahms' works. At the beginning of the first intermezzo, Sokolov chooses a more talkative approach, and the sound become like words. It is a more subjective approach. He also takes a lot of time at the end of the first sentence, which makes us feel a bit sleepy. In contrast, the sensitive pianist Julius Ketchen chooses more objective approach. He plays with a dreamy and flowing atmosphere. The competitor in the Arthur Rubinstein International Competition, Georgi Gigashvili, has a deep soul and a very strong emotional connection to musical elements in these three intermezzi. In part A of the first intermezzo, Brahms writes Andante Moderato, flowing but moderately. In part B, Brahms writes Più Adagio, slower. And when part A returns, Brahms writes un poco più andante, with a little more movement than part B. Gigashvili is very strict about these tempo instructions. After the first sentence in the first intermezzo, Brahms presents the first dialogue between her and him, between Clara and Brahms. The high note sounds like her voice, and the low ones sounds like his voice. Clara. Brahms. Sokolov almost plays his hands separately to emphasize the dialogue. That method was quite common in the past. Immediately after the dialogue, Sokolov enjoys the feeling of love that the dialogue creates and takes a lot of time to rest with pleasure. Ketchen emphasized the low sounds like Sokolov, but he plays the hands together and again stays with a more objective approach. Gigashvili plays his hands separately, but in an almost imperceptible way. ¶¶ after the dialogue, the first minor chord appears. Sokolov plays it with an intense sound and creates a feeling of concern, but immediately, in the next bar, when the major color returns, he plays it softer and gives it a feeling of relief. Julius Ketchen actually does the opposite. The intense worry in his playing turns into quiet disappointment in the minor chord and then becomes hope rich in sound in the major chord. After all that, the atmosphere changes. The harmony and the union that were there before disappear. Hollow octaves appear and bring loneliness with them. The magic is gone and sad questions arise. One can listen and watch how, when the hollow octaves arrive, Gigashvili is influenced by the unique feeling they create, both in the very distant color he produces in his fingers and in the expression of wonder in his face. Immediately after that, the low voice of Brahms in the left hand, which had previously spoken with love to Clara's high voice, became the musical manifestation of fate. The voice of fate. When Gigashvili plays this, his face has a serious expression, and so does the sound he produces. Then Brahms writes Molto Ritenuto to slow down and creates a feeling of dying or of a prolonged grip on the branch over an abyss of loneliness into which he's so afraid of being swallowed up. You can hear and watch all of these in Gigashvili's playing. In part B, which is, as mentioned, is the complete opposite, there is again a dialogue between Brahms and Clara, a dialogue of pain and sighs. Brahms writes to play pianissimo, very quiet, but with great expression. This instruction is not easy to follow because playing with great expression means playing with deep sound. You can hear how Sokolov puts emphasis on great expression and goes beyond the boundaries of pianissimo. In contrast, Ketchen plays very intimately, like a quiet whisperer. Thank you. When part A returns, one can see how Gigashvili treats this minor color beautifully and creates a strong sense of disappointment. In the second intermezzo, which is in B flat minor, the melody is the psi motif that appears a lot in the Romantic period and before. It contains two neighboring notes connected by a slur, forming a sad psi. Oh no, oh no. The quarta. Brahms' instructions, once again, are contradictory. Andante meaning quite flowing, and non troppo meaning not too much, and e con molto espressione meaning with great expression. But within the notes, he writes piano and dolce, intimate and sweet. Kechen and Sokolov play using a similar tempo and feeling. If we listen to Arthur Rubinstein, in two separate recordings, one from his youth and one from his adulthood, we would be surprised by the drastic tempo change. The melody cries in its solitude, the left hand caresses it, and then becomes a black wave of distress and darkness. Gigashvili shows how he is resisting being sucked into this black wave by slowing down before it arrives, as if he is trying to stop time from bringing him there. In a second wave of distress, there is a little hope, but out of this wave, part B begins. Sokolov creates an illuminating, intimate, and quiet moment that will then shatter to pieces, bringing a great dynamic anger. With K kitchen, the opposite happens. The bright moment is played with the rich sound, but then it darkens with disappointment and fatigue using a soft sound. In this dark wave, Brahms writes ritenuto, which means slow down, but without a tempo instruction afterward. This ends the slow down section and the part B begins. Sokolov treats this provision as if part B should be slow, flowing the slow down. The result is that Sokolov plays part B with a feeling of seriousness and a chorale sound full of serenity. But in contrast, Ketchen plays part B at the same tempo as part A. His playing sounds almost like a pastoral dance or a serenade of lovers. Also in this part, Brahms again uses the piano registration to create a dialogue of lovers. Brahms. Clara. In the end of part B, the magical atmosphere disappears with the arrival of hollow octaves and returns us to a bitter reality and the search for nothing. Like in the first intermezzo, Gigashvili is again influenced by the mysterious color of the hollow octaves and plays them in a very mystical way. This intermezzo contains great poetic and artistic marvels that combine many forces. The togetherness of the low voices, the heavenly high and solitary voice, and later, when the voice disappear, the low voices is very piercing. With the sigh motifs. Down in the left hand, the voice of fate appears and condemns the rest of the voices to loneliness. In Sokolov playing, all these elements can be clearly heard. Thank you. In Gigashvili's playing, you can also see these elements in his facial expressions and hear how beautifully he produces them with his fingers. The third and final intermezzo in C sharp minor begins with hollow octaves, which sounds as if a battle has been won. Brahms slowly fills these hollow octaves with harmony, as if to show that in his dreams he replaces his loneliness with an illusion of togetherness. But in this most harmonious place, there is also the greatest pain, because Brahms knows it's just a lie. Similar to the first intermezzo, Ketchen plays the third intermezzo much faster than Sokolov and with a general feeling of restlessness and searching. Sokolov, on the other hand, makes every note speak and plays at a much slower tempo than Ketchen. Gigashvili plays it with a serious and solemn sound, and again the color changes drastically as the hollow octaves return. Part B of the third intermezzo is almost a hallucination of another world, a world of sparks and illumination. Gigashvili uses the movement of his hand to create bells sound, and it drastically changes color when a memory of the dark wave arrives. A couple of bars afterward, Sokolov plays with thunderous dynamics, the likes of which are not heard in his playing of any of the other intermezzi. This makes it feel like cruel fate is knocking on Dream's door and reminds Brahms that he will have to return to reality soon. The end of this intermezzo, which closes the three intermezzi, has the same melodic line we hear at the very beginning, with the Brahms quarta motive rising, followed by the descending notes. Brahms is full of remorse, despair, and acceptance of his endless reality of loneliness. In the performances of Sokolov, Ketchen, and Gigashvili, one can hear their different kinds of sadness. Sokolov's sadness is turned inward. Ketchen's sadness is tormented and penetrating, and Gigashvili's sadness is terminal, like a stone weighing down one's heart until the bitter end. I'm Tal Chaim Samnon, and thank you so much for being with me.